I think it's time to prune some plants. What do you think? Time to prune some plants? Hi, everybody. This is a sacred datura. This is a mango beet. And this, yeah, you can't see it very well. This is a fig. These are my three demo plants for today. In this episode, I'm going to show you how to easily transplant and care for a plant like a datura, which is also known as gypsum weed, angel's trumpet, devil's trumpet, all kinds of funky names, but it's just a beautiful plant as far as I'm concerned. This is a plant that a lot of people really may have mistaken ideas about, and I want to bring in some common sense so that possibly you might want to enjoy this. And it's also time to transplant, and transplanting is always my funnest episode. So I want to show you how I transplant this without dying in the process. This right here, my mango beet, is something I'm growing and I'm actually enjoying it. You know, I'm not a competitive person. I never have been a competitive person. I told a friend that once. They were saying, well, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? I said, I don't like to compete. I don't like to compete. It doesn't make me feel good. But I entered this beet growing contest just because I wanted to grow a beet. And I figured, well, it's a great way to get a free seed to grow a beet. I'm gonna show you what's going on with this plant, because it may look a little bit funky, but there's nothing to be afraid of. This is actually a condition that you may be seeing going on in your plants. I'll show you a close-up in a minute on how to take care of this. Lastly, we have, well, you can't see it, but I'm gonna be showing you. We have a fig plant that I have here, a fig tree. Somebody gave me some fig trees, and it needs a little bit of upkeep. This will help give you a little bit of information on how to take care of more mature plants. You know, a lot of programs focus on how to take care of younger plants, because younger plants do need protection from crazy gardeners like me, but the older plants, they do have issues too. And over here, you may be able to see a little bit of it on the side of the frame. This is a Christmas cactus, or Thanksgiving cactus, or some freaking cactus. But this thing, as healthy as it looks, actually is in trouble. And I'm going to show you in next week's episode, because I got enough to do in this episode. So next episode, you're going to see something fun. I'm going to take on this plant, and I'm going to turn it into a healthy, thriving plant, because it really isn't healthy and thriving. And I'm going to show you why. So tune in next week when I take on this monster. It may help you if you're growing something like this as well. Okay, let's get started. But first, yeah, I know. Now let's get started. Let's go with the easiest one first. How's that sound? I'm gonna bring this over. It helps when you stick your tongue out when you do this. I'm gonna show you what this thing is doing. Come on over here and take a look at these leaves. The leaves are kind of curled over, and that's not really such a bad thing. All that means is this plant is getting a lot of nitrogen, and that's actually not a bad thing. Well, I mean, it isn't for me, because I love beet greens. I found out that I really do like beet greens. Can't stand beets, but I love beet greens. So excess nitrogen is actually doing a good thing for this plant. You may have heard or read somewhere that if you give your plants too much nitrogen, your plants will put out all kinds of leaves at the expense of putting in a strong root system or flowers or fruit. Sorry to disagree with the masses, but that is absolutely not true. If you give your plants a lot of nitrogen, they will put out a lot of good green growth, but as long as you give your plants the other things they need, like calcium, phosphorus, things like that, they will still put out fruit, flowers, roots, they'll do all of that. So the excess nitrogen isn't gonna just, you know, cancel out everything else. It's gonna work in conjunction with that. Because look, what I do with this is I give it a well-balanced, very high potent fertilizer, and that means high nitrogen. So when you see this happening in your pepper leaves and stuff, don't freak out. Your plant isn't dying, or any other plant. That just means that it's getting a lot of nitrogen, and that's actually okay. And but with the extra fertilizer, take a look down here. See right there? Look at that beet. That is a big honking healthy beet, isn't it? Yeah. And that means that it's getting everything else that it needs. It wouldn't be putting out a big fat root if it didn't get the stuff that it needs to put out good roots. And I'm sure eventually this thing is going to put out flowers, but we don't grow beets for flowers, really. But what I wanted to show you this up close for is that when you see the leaves curl over, that just means it's getting a lot of nitrogen, and that's okay sometimes. But if you don't want that to happen, just cut back on the nitrogen. And also, since this plant is growing so big and so furious, I don't really need all these leaves laying down like this. Because when a leaf curls over like this, the one bad thing that it does is when it's curled down, what's it doing? It's not picking up light as much. Plants need to have their leaves like this in order to take full advantage of the light sources, which are generally from above. So when they're curled like this, generally only this is getting the full advantage of the light. This really isn't. So these leaves are not working at their full potential. These are the factory of your plant. They need to be out here like this to really draw in the energy. So what I'm going to do, these are actually very delicious. I'm going to cut these all off at the base level, and I'm going to eat these. So this will get rid of all of this here. Oh, where are my pruners? Pruning is really not so bad. Just take my little needle nose pruners, and this is why I like the needle nose instead of the big pruners. You can really get in here so easily. Snip, snip. Simple. Go around the plant very fast. Oh wow, beet juice is coming out of these things. That. And normally outside, I guess you wouldn't be pruning your beet leaves off. You just let them go, but you know what? You get the beet, which is nice, you know, if you like beets. But in the meantime, take a look. I got tons and tons, well, not tons, pounds and pounds of great greens. These can be diced up, tossed in. I'm having a stir fry tonight. I have a little bit of pork left over, and I'm going to throw that in with some cabbage, and I also have some beet greens. So I'm going to chop this up instead of cabbage because I like cabbage, but I thought, what the heck? I'm going to throw this, I'm going to use this with my cabbage, and I'm going to have a great stir fry with something, and you know this is good for you. Beets are good for you. Beet greens, I believe they are just like the beets. They're going to have a lot of iron in them, a lot of iron, a lot of nutrition, so these are not a waste product. And then my plant is all ready to grow some more, and it brings the leaves up off of here. Win-win situation for everybody. Wow. That really is quite a harvest, you know, from one seed, indoor growing. I have quite a bit to put on my dinner table tonight. That's pretty good. Good nutrition, fun to grow, it's great. I really do recommend, if you want to grow something fun inside, beets are the way to go. They are really fun. You know, one of these days, I'm going to grow spinach and see how that does inside, since I seem to be doing pretty good at beets. All right, let's move on to the next one. This is a fig. And a friend online, and I don't remember who it was. I know I get a lot of flack for not remembering who these people are, but you know who you are. She sent me two fig trees, and this one was a tall stick, and I cut it back, and it grew really nice. And then it started putting out figs. It actually has figs growing on the bottom, I think, unless they all fell off. Nope, it still has a fig or two. But what happens is this is starting to get a bit of a fungus. What type of fungus? Who knows? I don't care. All I know is fungus, no good. Fungus is never good on your leaves. And you can get things like powdery mildew, blight, you can get downy mildew, all different kinds of stuff on your leaves. And what'll happen is the spores generally hit your plants underneath. People make the mistake of whenever they get a mildew or some kind of leaf problem, they spray the top of their leaves. Doesn't do any good because it's underneath the leaves. It just shows the symptoms on the top of the leaves. So when you do spray your plants, and I do, I have a mixture of neem and pyrethrin here for when I spray bugs, and I spray underneath, and I also have a spray bottle with some baking soda. It's 1 tablespoon of baking soda per quart of water. No other weird stuff. You just mix it all in, spray the undersides of your leaves. Just mist them, takes care of the fungus problem. Make sure that you get the tops, bottoms, and the soil. Fungus problems are all taken care of. I don't care what kind of fungus it is. It takes care of it. The baking soda changes the pH, and that actually keeps the fungus from growing because they need a very specific pH. What they need, I don't know. All I know is baking soda changes that, makes it very unhealthy for them, and the fungus dies. It's totally harmless to your plants. Wonderful thing to do. All right, let's get Ray a little bit more caffeinated. Okay, let's get you in here close, and I want to show you what kind of upkeep this needs. And basically, the plant is hurting itself, and I'm going to intervene and show you how to keep this plant growing good. Very easy tip. Come on over. Here's a nice close-up view. The new leaves are beautiful. Take a look at that. Love the color on these things. And here are the old leaves that are having a bit of an issue. What their issue is doesn't concern me. All I know is I don't want it on there. You know, it isn't really necessarily essential for me to properly diagnose everything. All I need to know is that isn't healthy. It's got to go. So it's pruning time. See right here? We have some issues, basically spotting, lightning color. And you really can't see anything happening underneath. That's generally the nature of a fungal attack. You don't see the actual fungus because you're going to need a very, very strong magnifying glass to see it. All you need to know is that your leaves are unhealthy. And that's one of the common sense things that I practice. And it has to do with, don't worry too much about the small stuff. If I see something like this going on, I may not know what it is. I'm no expert. All I know is I don't want it on my plant, so away it goes. And if it reappears, then maybe I'll go a little bit more crazy and try to figure out what it is. But I don't try to figure everything out. Now, what I'm doing here is I'm removing the older leaves, and even if I have a slightly healthy one here, I really don't need it because I have a lot of new growth coming out. And I'm removing this old growth because it's not that healthy, and what it's doing is it's shading the new growth. And once I remove these old leaves, let me move the plant over a little bit. Once I remove the old leaves, it's going to allow some light in so that the new leaves can grow a lot faster. Because if you have the old leaves shading these, what's happening is the old leaves really aren't producing that much because they're a little bit, I don't know, funky. So they're not doing their job properly. And they're shading the new leaves, which are not infected. And the new leaves can't do their job properly. So what you have is you have a lose-lose situation. Once I remove the old leaves and allow the new leaves to show underneath the light, they can start producing energy to help the plant grow a lot better. And oh, by the way, where is that? Oh, there it is. Yeah. See, my little fig. It'll probably fall off like the other ones because this plant is not very old, so the figs are falling off. And I really don't care because I wasn't growing this for figs right away. I'd like to get a more established plant before it starts fruiting, because if you have a very young plant and it tries to fruit, that's a lot of stress on that plant. So I like to actually forego the fruiting, even though it may be fun, it may look good. It's really not the best thing in the plant, and I'm in this for the long run. I'm not in this just to have a plant for one season and to gloat over what I can do with a plant. I want this plant to produce for many, many years in my house or even outside. So I'm going to forego the fruit, and I just wanted to show you this, but off it comes. Sorry, Mr. Fig, you got to go because the mother plant really doesn't need you right now. But take a look. Beautiful. Now, after I end this episode, I'm going to take a spray bottle of baking soda and water and give this a misting underneath the leaves and on top and on the soil. That'll take care of everything having to do with this fungal problem. Put it back underneath the light. It's going to just boost the growth on this. Very, very simple fix. And any old leaves that you find in here, take those out before you spray because they may have spores on them. And that's all there is to keeping a plant healthy, getting it growing again. Just snip, snip, spray, and you are all set to go. No need to worry. Fig juice. Ooh, that's nasty. Looks pretty good. And it's just that easy. Ah, easier than moving it. Okay, last thing on the agenda. Here's my common sense tip. Oh yes, I'm wearing these because one of the things about growing deadly plants. And I don't do this to show off, you know, what I can grow. I do this because I grew it once and I like the smell of the flower. So I'm growing it because I like the smell of the flower. And I know there's a lot of flowers that do smell good, but I like this one. So I am adjusting my pattern and how I do things around my plant. I'm not trying to adjust my plant around me. So with respect for the plant and what it can do, because you don't want to touch this plant if you don't have to. So I'm having latex gloves. I don't have to use this very often, but once in a blue moon, I have to actually transplant this thing. So I want to make sure. Look at me, I got white gloves. Okay, but I want to make sure that I'm not actually hurting myself. The leaves, the stem, the roots, the sap, everything about this plant is dangerous. So you have to actually have some respect for your plants. I think it's actually quite fascinating. You know, some plants like this, they are delicious. They are good for us. They are everything that we as humans love about nature. Good stuff. And then there are other plants, and these plants have developed to a stage where, you know what? They don't want to be eaten. They don't like the idea of being in our stomach. So they have developed ways to keep us from attacking them. And I think that's actually quite fascinating, because there is, you know, you think about animals as having intelligence, and you know, a lot of vegans, they don't really much care for the idea of slaughtering animals and eating animals, and I respect their beliefs. The thing is that they're thinking as animals as, you know, having intelligence, awareness, things like that. You know, plants do have quite an awareness going on. I know that sounds really guru, hippie type stuff, but it's actually true. Think about it. Plants have evolved by knowing what's going on in their environment. You have plants that develop poisons. You have plants that develop certain kinds of flowers that will only attract certain kinds of pollinators. You have plants that grow like spider plants. You know, those indoor spider plants. They will put out a stem and with little babies on the end. You know why they do that? They do that because when they're root bound, in nature, they're grass, and they grow, if they grow between rocks, they can't go anywhere. They know they're trapped. They send out these long stalks to go over the thing that's blocking them and send down babies. It's really cool. Strawberries do the same thing. They send out this runner and it goes over and it hits the ground. Plants tend to have this weird awareness, and I think that's fascinating. And it's just one of those things that I really love about plants, because they're not stupid little green slaves to our every whim. Some of them can actually teach us a few things, and I think that's great. So what I'm going to do with this thing is I'm going to cut off a few of the leaves, because I want to make sure when I transplant it, I'm going to take it down a little bit deeper than it was before. This thing, these kind of plants, have a lot of roots, a lot of roots that go everywhere, and they're very close to the surface, and they're very deep down. They go everywhere. So I want to make sure that the roots go a little bit farther down. This will help my plant not dry out quite as much, because if you plant it to where the root line is the same when you transplant it, you're still keeping those roots at the same level. If you bury them just a little bit more, put a little soil on them, it keeps them moister longer, and that will help your plant grow a lot healthier, and you won't have to be going crazy trying to keep it watered. And also, I'm gonna have to wash these off when I'm done. And also, it will keep you from, where am I gonna put these? You, hold this. Okay, done deal. Let's get this taken care of, and I should really shut up and do what you're here to see me do. I mixed up some soil, and it's really kind of a cool mix. You know, I use that fertilizer mix with the urea and all the other crap in it. The thing is that being organic, a lot of organic fertilizers don't have a pleasant smell. You know, you'll be using fish fertilizer. What's it smell like? It smells like a fish. And you use other kinds of stuff like kelp. Ooh, kelp reeks. And they just don't smell good, because organic fertilizers are what? They're made out of living things, you know, all crushed up, rotted, and that's what plants live off of. So of course they're not going to smell good. You want something that smells good? Go get yourself some potpourri or something. But organics are sometimes going to smell, and that's just what you have to deal with. Now, what I'm going to do is find a pot. Oh no, I have to use my seat for this one. Yep. Really? Don't I have anything better? Okay, fine, whatever. You can have it. Plants come first. I can always sit on the ground. All right. You know what's coming next. Come on over. Let's do this. All right. Now, as I've said in other episodes, the first thing I want to do is find out approximately what the height of this plant's going to be, and then look inside. And I can see that I need about a couple inches of soil to rest this on. And this soil that I mix up, I mentioned before, is half coir, which is cocoa peat, half generic potting mix, and a heavy, heavy sprinkle of vermiculite. That's all it is. So there really isn't a whole lot of nutrition in here. What I did is something a little different. I took that brick of dried coir and I soaked it in a bucket with my fertilizer mix with water. So I mixed in the fertilizer with the water, and then I soaked the cocoa peat in it. And so that way, the moisture that's in here is actually going to feed the plant for a long time. All right, tap this down. And let's see. Oh, not bad for a first try, huh? Okay, now for transplanting a plant, you know, the younger plants are so much easier because they're in smaller containers. Transplanting a mature plant is a little bit more tricky, because you got to be careful. These things are big and they're heavy. We just take this upside down. Come on, get out of the pot. All right, you know the secret weapon. Ugh. Ha 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 ha. Look at the roots. It's just perfect, not too root bound, and that's what we want to see. If you wait until your plants are root bound, sometimes you're going to have issues. All right, let's shake all the dirt off, set them down, and as soon as you're done transplanting a datura, you want to make sure that even if you're wearing gloves like this, wash your arms, wash your hands, make sure that you get all that off of you. You know, I'm not trying to scare you, because the thing is that with a little common sense, this isn't going to be a bad thing. And you can grow this safely. You know, people say, well, you got to keep that away from kids and dogs. And I'm thinking, why aren't you keeping track of your kids and your dogs? Of course, if you're going to grow a plant like this, you don't want it around your kids or dogs. Same thing with all kinds of plants. There are all kinds of common plants that can be dangerous. And don't blame the plant, blame yourself if you're not watching your kids. You know, if you do have kids that run around and touch your plants, maybe you shouldn't be growing this, you know? And I have a dog, but he's not interested in my plants. He just isn't. I know his nature, and I've watched him. He couldn't care less about these. He loves the ones outside, doesn't like these. He sniffs around in dirt, but he never did care for the actual plants. So I have no worries. And plus, he never comes up here without me. He just doesn't climb the stairs. I have to actually carry him, the lazy butt. And that's all we do. Just tap it down nice and gentle. We are all set to go. We'll give it a little water, and this plant is going to grow in this container more than likely the rest of its life. So we're never going to have to do this again. Oh, by the way, one thing I want to mention is, see these pots? They have a built-in drip tray, so I don't have to worry about overwatering. And I don't overwater. I always look at my pot and I go, okay, when it's empty like this, I feel it. And I feel how heavy it is. And when it feels like that again, it's time to water. And also, you can tell by the top of the soil. When it really dries out, you lift up your pot a little bit. You can tell when it feels dry. Get to know your plants. Get to know when they're moist, when they're dry. And by the way, this one did flower. You can see that it flowered. And it was a nice flower, but it's kind of half dead. So when you're transplanting, always make sure you do it after your flowers. Oh, this one died. After your flowers are gone, snip those off. And if your plant has fruit on it, like a pepper plant or tomato plant, don't be surprised if it drops the buds or drops the fruit. That's what it does for an adjustment period, because this is actually a hard time for a plant, and it will grow more. So if it drops a little fruit, hey, that's okay. It's going to grow some more. Don't worry about it. Okay, we are all set. We've trimmed off the old flower. We transplanted it with the leaves off the bottom. We are all set to go. It's just that easy, folks. These get tossed. Ugh. I think this can go to recycling somehow. I'll have to check with my city and see what you do with old latex gloves. Ugh. Nasty. Okay, I do believe we are done. That's all there is to it, folks. Taking care of more mature plants in your house is so simple. Don't overthink it. And that's where a lot of the problem comes is people overthink things and then they get a little worried. Don't overthink things. Keep your brain empty like me and just take the easiest path. Generally, the most direct path is the one that's going to work for your plants. Plants are not complicated creatures. If you think like a plant, you can do just fine. And that's what I do. I guess I think like a plant, and that's why I do so well. If you have any questions about your stuff, please, please, please feel free to ask me. I'm more than happy to always answer your questions as best as I can. I'm not always right, but I'm always here. And by the way, one last thing before I go. If you haven't heard of my other channel, which I can't believe you wouldn't, I'm going to put a link right below the thing, and it's called the Voodoo Garden Channel. The Voodoo Garden Channel is kind of a more lighthearted, just showing strange things going on in the grow room up here. And I like to keep that channel separate from this one because this is more like tips, demos, how-tos, things like that. And the Voodoo Garden episode is for when I'm just feeling a little bit stupid and I want to hang out with you. So if you want to check out that, go down to the expanded description below, click on that, subscribe to the Voodoo Garden channel. And what I'd like to do on the next episode, if you don't mind, post a question anywhere here in the comment section for me. And I will take those questions and I will put them on the Voodoo Garden channel and do a weekend edition. Yes, I will. A weekend edition is a fun thing that I used to like doing all the time. And every now and then I do one because it's just fun to just sit here and not have to, you know, mess with the plants, just answer your questions. It's a little bit of back and forth between you and me. If you have any questions concerning the care of your indoor plants, whether they're vegetable or regular house plants, by the way, I do have quite a bit of experience with indoor house plants, spider plants, philodendrons, things like that. Those of you who have been here for quite a while, you saw that I did a monstera, which is a huge, it's called a split leaf philodendron. I had that thing growing so big, I didn't know what to do with it, so I took a knife to it. Yeah, I knifed that thing, and it wasn't pretty. But if you have any questions at all, post them in the comment section. I will select a few of those questions, and on the next Voodoo Garden episode, which is not very far from now, I'm going to do a weekend edition and answer your questions as best as I can. How's that sound? Okay, I think I'm pretty much done. Don't forget, Voodoo Garden, questions, subscribe, questions, and also the next episode of the Praxis Channel. Oh, I love this shirt. This is going to be my new uniform. On the next episode of the Praxis Channel coming in a week, I'm going to drag this huge thing. It looks like Tina Turner's hair back in the 80s when she was singing. Yeah, I'm going to drag this monster in, and I am going to prune it for better health, and I'm going to transplant it. I have not touched this plant in like 7 years. Yes, 7 years. That is nuts. Time for this plant to get a makeover, and I want you to join me on the Praxis Channel because it's going to be pretty extreme. Okay, I gotta get going, everybody. Thank you for joining me up in the grow room once again. Have a great day. Bye. Okay, I need some water for this thing. Yeah, we need some water.